will be seeing one important topic, that is Brucella. So what is this Brucella? It is a genus of gram-negative bacteria which is named after David Bruce. He is a British general doctor. So actually this Brucella, which are gram-negative, they are very small. They measure around 0.5 to 0.7 into 0.6 to around 1 micrometer. And these are non-capsulated, non-motile, facultatively intracellular coccobacilli. So remember, Brucella is a gram-negative coccobacilli. And it is responsible for a condition called as brucellosis. You might have heard something brucellosis. So in this session, we will be seeing what is brucellosis and few points about Brucella. So before going into the topic, we will know some of the other names of brucellosis. So brucellosis, when it causes a disease in humans, it is known as Malta fever, undulant fever, Mediterranean fever, gastric fever, or rock fever of Gibraltar. The same brucellosis, when it causes diseases in animals, it is called as Banks disease, enzootic abortion, dizootic abortion, slinking of calves, and contagious abortion. So basically, you should know that brucellosis is more commonly known as Malta fever. Why Malta fever? It was discovered in Malta, place known as Malta, by the British medical officers around 1850s, during the Crimean War. So that's why it is known as Malta fever. So now coming to Brucella. To know about the taxonomy of Brucella, it belongs to the phylum Proteobacteria, class Alpha Proteobacteria, order Rhizobiales, family Brucellaceae, and genus Brucella. And coming to what are the species included in Brucella, we will see in further slides. So coming to the history, there are a few men who are mostly associated with Brucella in the history. First coming to Sir William Burnet. He was a physician general to the British Navy. Navy, many soldiers are affected with different types of fever. So he differentiated the various fevers affecting soldiers. Then Jeffrey Marston, he himself contracted Malta fever from the patient, and he described his own case in great detail, which was more significant in knowing more about the organism. And coming to Bang, he was a Danish physician and veterinarian. He discovered the bacilli called as Bacterium abortus, which infected cattle, horses, sheep, and goats. So what happened at the time? He isolated bacillus as a causative agent which was causing spontaneous abortions in cows, and so the condition was named as Banks disease. At that time, no one knew that particular bacilli had anything to do with the causative agent in Malta fever. Simply a bacillus was discovered, which was the causative agent for Banks disease. Then coming to Sir David Bruce, he isolated a bacteria which was then known as Micrococcus melitensis. Later its name was changed. He was a British army doctor, and he discovered from the spleens of infected persons. So this Malta fever, I said. So Malta fever has got the name because it was first discovered from the Malta Island during the Crimean War. And Brucella is named as Brucella because of David Bruce, who identified it first. So this is about the history related to Brucella. Then coming to the classification. See, here you can see there are about 6 species of Brucella which are pathogenic. That is Melitensis, Abortus, Suis, Canis, Ovis, and Neonotomy. So these 6 species are classified based on difference of animal host, carbon dioxide requirement, hydrogen sulfide production, urease, and tolerance to bacteriostatic types like Theonin or basic fustian, or agglutination with monospecific antiserum, that is predominantly A or M antigen of the lipopolysaccharide, and also by lysis by the bacteriophage, mostly Bilisei. This is an important one among all the bacteriophages. So what is it mostly affect? Cattle. So abortus affects only cattle, whereas suis, as the name itself suggests, it affects pigs mostly. So remember these 3 points. Whereas coming to urease production, militancies, it is variable, it shows variable urease production, whereas abortus, they are slow urease producing organisms, whereas suis, they are rapid ones to produce urease. So how are the 6 species of Brucella are classified? Based on carbon dioxide requirement, hydrogen sulfide production, urease and tolerance to bacteriostatic types such as basic first in anthionine and lysis by bacteriophage and agglutination by monospecific antiserum, predominantly A or M antigen, which resides on the lipopolysaccharides. So Brucella melitensis resides on which animals acts as a reservoir? Sheep and goats. Whereas for abortus, it is cattle. And for suis, it is pig. Okay. So this classification is kept under Norman system of classification. Then coming to the morphology. These are gram-negative coccobacilli. They are obligate aerobes. Obligate aerobes means they survive only in the presence of oxygen. But sometimes they can tolerate up to 5-10% of carbon dioxide also. They are fastidious organisms, non-sporing, non-motile and non-capsulated. Then coming to the human infection, it is usually associated with the occupational or domestic exposure to the infected animals or their products, mostly sheep, goat, cattle and pigs also. This is about the morphology of Brucella. Coming to the antigenic structure, it is very important. As I already said, the major species of Brucella are classified based on this property also of lipopolysaccharide antigens, that is M and A. So here you can see the figure. In Brucella abortus, A antigen is the predominant, whereas M antigen is not predominant. It occurs in the ratio of 20:1. Whereas melitensis, M antigen is predominant when compared to A antigen. In suis, there is no hard and fast rule that only one antigen should be predominant. It can be either A antigen or M antigen. So remember, when you say melitensis M, so M antigen is the predominant one. When you say abortus, A antigen is the predominant one. So yes, either of the antigen can be predominant. So these antigens, they are present in varying proportions in the 3 major species of Brucella. Then coming to the pathogenesis or transmission. So transmission, it occurs from infected animals to the man. And remember, there is no man-to-man transmission for brucellosis. Transmission always occurs from infected animals to man. So the direct contact, most common route is through contact with infected animals, infected animal tissue or blood, urine, vaginal discharge or placenta with abraded skin or mucosa of men who are involved in animal handling. So this is the most common route, but it can also transmit through foodborne route, that is through ingestion of raw milk or dairy products, that is consumption of infected unpasteurized milk or like any milk or dairy products. And it can also transmit through airborne route, that happens through inhalation of dust or aerosols in the infected cow shed or slaughterhouses. So in the slaughterhouses, because of inhalation of dust or aerosols, even this brucellosis can be transmitted. But remember, there is no man-to-man transmission of brucellosis. Transmission always occurs from infected animals to man. So what happens initial, from the initial site of infection, it spreads to the local lymph nodes. From there, it gets spilled over to the bloodstream in the blood. It causes infection there in the blood, leading to bacteremia. From there, it can disseminate to various organs. So these are, as I already said, these are facultative intracellular pathogens. So they primarily or mostly infect reticuloendothelial system because they are facultatively intracellular pathogens. And they mostly placenta, because of erythritol present in that, so they have special predilection, or they are more predisposed to infection in placenta. Even musculoskeletal tissues and genitourinary system are also involved. So what happens to the local tissue response? Initially there will be an acute neutrophilic infiltration, which leads to inflammatory cells, which progresses rapidly forming to a granuloma. Now coming to the virulence factors, as I already said, the antigens which are responsible for causing virulence injuries are two antigens. What are those? One is M antigen and the other one is A antigen. So the endotoxin activity is actually very low, but it plays a key role in these properties, like to cause resistance to phagocytosis or to suppress the phagosome lysosome fusion and to develop pyrogenicity. So what are these three? We'll see in this life cycle of Drosella. So as I already said, it is a facultative intracellular organism. So all the life cycle that happens in the host cells, because it is a facultative intracellular. So what happens during infection? Drosella first invade the host cell. Here see, Drosella is first invading the host cell. After invading the host cell, it forms the Drosella containing vacuoles, BCP. After invading the host cell, it forms the Drosella containing vacuoles. Then it undergoes fusion with the lysosome. It undergoes fusion with the lysosome in a controlled manner in the third step. So what happens after undergoing fusion with the lysosome? In this step, about 90% of Drosella, they are degraded, and only the 10% survive. So the 10% of the Drosella which survives, they traffic with each other and to reach the endoplasmic reticulum and establish the replicative site there. Okay, they establish the replicative site in the endoplasmic reticulum. So after endoplasmic reticulum replication, the Drosella traffic towards the, they move towards the autophagy-like vacuoles. They move towards the autophagy-like vacuoles and they survive in the compartments and finally leave the host cells to promote cell-to-cell spreading, as it is a facultative intracellular organism. So for all these steps to occur, it takes the help of type 4 secretory system. Okay, so what is this? First what happens, life cycle of Drosella, it takes place within the host cells, as it is a facultative intracellular organism. So what happens during infection? Drosella first invade the host cells, forming Drosella containing vacuoles. Then it undergoes fusion with the lysosome in a phased or controlled manner. In this step, 90% of the Drosella gets degraded and only 10% they survive. So these 10% Drosella which survive, they traffic to and reach the endoplasmic reticulum and establish the replicative site there. Means they start replication in the endoplasmic reticulum. After endoplasmic reticulum replication, they move towards the autophagy-like molecules and they survive within the compartments of this autophagy-like vacuoles. And finally, they leave the host cells to promote cell-to-cell spreading. So, which secretion system is mostly responsible for this Drosella? Type 4 secretion system. It regulates the intracellular survival in the phagosomes. So, apart from these virulence factors of lipopolysaccharide, NMR, N-antigen and type 4 secretion systems, there are few other virulence factors also, like copper, zinc, superoxide dismutase and nucleotide-like substances. So, the function of this copper, zinc, superoxide dismutase is, it inhibits reactive oxygen radicals, mostly in Drosella abortus. And nucleotide-like substances, they inhibit phagolysosome fusion and reactive oxygen radicals produced from the neutrophils. This is once again seen in the species of abortus, that is Drosella abortus mostly. So this is about the pathogenesis, transmission and virulence factors of Drosella. Coming to the host's immune response, as always, the cell-mediated immunity plays a key role to control the infection. So what happens when the first T helper 1 cells, they get activated? They activate the interferon gamma cells, which in turn activate the macrophages, and there will be killing of the intracellular bacilli. In this case, it is Brucella. So what happens when there is T helper 2 cell activation? It goes and attacks the interleukins 4, 6 and 10, which downregulates the protective T helper 1 immune response and stimulates the humoral immunity. And antibodies don't play, or they play a minor role, because these are intracellular organisms, and as these are antibodies, they are very ineffective, or they play a minor role on intracellular organisms. About the immune response of Brucella. Then coming to the clinical manifestations, the incubation period, it is 1 week to several months. You have to remember one thing, the classic triad of the symptoms of brucellosis, that is fever with profuse night sweats, arthralgia or arthritis, and hepatosplenomegaly. So the classic triad of brucellosis is fever with profuse night sweats, arthralgia or arthritis, and hepatosplenomegaly. And the fever which it causes, they cause typhoid like illness, except that it is less acute when compared to typhoid, and it is less severe, and it has a typical peculiar pattern, that is undulating pattern of fever, and it involves more of musculoskeletal systems. Skeletal system is mostly not involved, or it involves to a minor degree in typhoid like illness. So what is this undulating fever? We'll see later. So coming to the I said here it involves more musculoskeletal systems. In almost 50% of the patients of brucellosis, when they have this musculoskeletal systems, these symptoms mimic skeletal tuberculosis symptoms, and also they can cause vertebral osteomyelitis, mostly affects the lower thoracic and lumbar vertebrae, and it can also cause septic arthritis involving knee, hip, sacroiliac and shoulder joints. So coming to this undulating fever, it has a typical repetitive course, means there will be rising and falling of the fever, typical course. So apart from the classical triad, it can also affect almost all the organs. First, coming to the ocular system, it can cause keratitis, corneal ulcer, uveitis or endophthalmitis. Whereas coming to pulmonary symptoms, it can cause bronchitis, bronchopneumonia, hilar lymphadenopathy, lung abscess, pleural effusion. Whereas gastrointestinal symptoms include hepatitis, ileitis, pancreatitis, cholecystitis and primary bacterial peritonitis. Whereas cutaneous infections like erythema nodosum or vasculitis. Whereas when it affects central nervous system, it can lead to conditions like meningitis, encephalitis, psychosis, peripheral neuropathy, polyradiculitis. CVS, it leads to conditions like endocarditis, myocarditis or pericarditis. Whereas genitourinary symptoms include epididymoarthritis, pyelonephritis, glomerulonephritis, interstitial nephritis and abortions also. Not only in animals but in humans also, sometimes it leads to abortions. Okay, but the studies haven't proven it yet. Okay, skeletal system, it includes, as I already said, it can cause arthritis or osteomyelitis. These are about the clinical manifestations of brucellosis. Coming to the epidemiology, it is a zoonotic disease because infection spreads from animals to man. It is worldwide in distribution, and the endemic areas means where the animals are reared in large numbers, brucellosis is more prevalent there, that is in Mediterranean zone, Eastern Europe, Central Asia, Mexico and South America. It is very rare in most European countries, Australia and North America. So the true prevalence of human brucellosis is very difficult to estimate. Why? Because most of the cases of brucellosis are underreported because of inapparent in urine, milk, placenta or vaginal discharge, or contaminated animal food products, mostly the dairy products, especially cheeses, milk, ice cream, or rarely raw meats and bone marrows. So people who are at higher risk, those who work with the cattle, that is farmers, shepherds, abattoir workers or butchers in the endemic areas mostly. So this is about brucella and few points about brucellosis. Then coming to the lab diagnosis. So lab diagnosis, sample collection always starts with the area which it infects. Here in this case, mostly you can go for like bone marrow, cerebrospinal fluid, joint fluid or other tissues. And the blood, when you collect, it should be collected during the febrile period. There is a typical undulant fever pattern. So it should be collected during the febrile period before starting the antibiotics. And multiple blood cultures over 3 consecutive days are taken actually because for a better result. That too, 5 to 10 ml should be collected 2 to 3 times a day. 5 to 10 ml twice or thrice a day for 3 consecutive days is actually a protocol for collecting blood to rule out brucellosis. So when all should the blood be collected? Blood should be collected for 3 consecutive days. The quantity 5 to 10 ml twice or thrice a day. So actually bone marrow culture, it remains positive even after starting antibiotics. So it gives higher yield of bacteria, that is brucella, than the blood culture. But as the bone marrow culture, it's very difficult to obtain. Most of the times physicians prefer to collect blood. So blood when you collect, okay, we'll see that later. Before that, we'll see few points about culture. As I already said, it is highly fastidious organism and growth is enhanced by addition of the blood or serum. These are obligate aerobes. They require only oxygen to grow, but sometimes it can grow even in the presence of minute quantities of carbon dioxide, that is 5 to 10% carbon dioxide. And remember, this brucella organisms are very slow growers. So primary isolation, they require prolonged incubation at 37 degrees centigrade for several weeks. Actually, it is about for 2 to 4 weeks. Normally, the bacteria, it grows after an overnight incubation. But brucellosis, it has to be incubated brucella organism, for it to grow, it has to be incubated for around 2 to 4 weeks. Prolonged incubation at 37 degrees centigrade. And the culture media required is biphasic media, castaneda media. So what is the specialty of this castaneda media? Biphasic, name itself shows. It has both solid media and the liquid media. So the sample inoculated bottle has to be tilted to flow the broth over the solid medium and keep it in upright position at 37 degrees centigrade. Why? Because the growth of brucella is extremely slow. So apart from this biphasic media, that is castaneda media, you can also go for brain heart infusion broth or agar, or serum dextrose broth or agar. Advantage is it has very less contamination rate. And the disadvantage, as the organism is slow grower, it has to be incubated at 37 degrees Celsius for 2 to 4 weeks or sometimes more. So this is about the culture media. And the automated systems which are used are BACTEC and BACTIALERT. The advantage of this system is it takes less time for isolation, that is around 1 week. Okay, so that the results are obtained faster and the treatment is initiated earlier, so that the recovery rates are better. Then coming to the culture on normal routine media. The routine media which we use is blood agar and chocolate agar here. On the blood agar, you can see small, smooth, transparent, low convex, hemolytic colonies. Same on blood agar and also chocolate agar. Whereas on gram staining, as I already said, they appear as gram negative cocoa bacilli. And these are non-motile, non-capsulated and non-sporing organisms. Then coming to the biochemical tests. So these are catalyst positive, oxidase positive. Okay, urease test, it is variable, but most oftenly it is positive, that is rapidly positive, especially with Suez and Canis. Nitrates are reduced to nitrites except Brucella ovis. And coming to imbic reactions, these are negative. What are imbic reactions? Indole, methyl red, citrate and Vogts proscure. So all these four tests are negative and they do not ferment carbohydrates. So what are the positive biochemical tests for these Brucella? Catalyst positive, oxidase positive, urease test mostly positive, nitrates are reduced to nitrites. What are the negative reactions, negative biochemical reactions? Imbic are negative, that is indole, methyl red, citrate, Vogts proscure are negative and they do not ferment carbohydrates. Okay, so this is about biochemical tests. So coming to nomen species identification, as I already said, so how are the species of Brucella classified? One is based on preference of animal host, carbon dioxide requirement, hydrogen sulfide production, also urease, and tolerance to bacteriostatic dyes like theonin and basic fustian, or agglutination with the antiserum, that is redundant M or A antigen of lipopolysaccharide, and lysis by bacteriophage, mostly Belisephage. It is concerned with brucellosis. Okay, so M antigen is mostly predominant in which species of Brucella? Melitensis. Whereas A antigen is predominant in Brucella abortus. Whereas in Suez, either MM or A antigen is predominant. Then coming to the serological tests, these are done for detecting antibodies. So there is a standard agglutination test for diagnosing or identifying Brucella. It is a gold standard test. Gold standard test means against which the other serological tests can be compared. So the principle involved is tube agglutination test, like that of Weidel test. And the significant titer is more than 1 in 160 in non-endemic areas. And in endemic areas, it depends on the particular endemic titer of that particular area. But in non-endemic titers, usually it is taken as the titer more than 1 in 160. In endemic areas, demonstration of rising titer by repeating the test after 2 to 4 weeks is more reliable. Agglutination test, it detects antibodies against the antigens of smooth lipopolysaccharide antigens, not the rough lipopolysaccharide antigens. So that's why the use of Brucella abortus can detect antibodies against Brucella melitensis, abortus and Suez, but not Canis, because Canis doesn't have the smooth lipopolysaccharides. So it is not used to detect Brucella Canis. And the standard agglutination test, they measure total quantity of agglutinating antibodies, but they do not differentiate between immunoglobulin isotypes. In acute infection, not only in this infection, in any infection, in acute infection, IgM antibodies, they appear early and then followed by IgG antibodies or IgA antibodies. So as the disease progresses, what happens? IgM levels decline and IgA levels increase. Thus, this standard agglutination test may become negative. And the standard agglutination test, it has many false negative and false positive reactions also. So we have to see few conditions where it shows us false negative standard agglutination test, and in few conditions where it shows us false positive. So false negative standard agglutination test may occur due to these the following conditions. What is false negative? False negative test means a test result which wrongly indicates that a particular condition is absent, a particular condition or disease is absent. So here for the standard agglutination test, you can see under these things. One is prozone phenomenon. What is prozone phenomenon? Where there is high antibody titer which interferes with the formation of antigen antibody lattice. 4% saline to dilute patient serum on my Coombs agglutination test, which is most reliable if false negative conditions are fixed. And coming to false positive. False positive means a test result which wrongly indicates that a particular disease or condition is present. So it is due to some antigenic cross reactions of Escherichia coli, O157, Francisella tularensis, Salmonella enterica group, Stenotrophomonas maltophila, and Vibrio cholera. Okay. So there are a few other serological tests to detect IgG antibody. One is 2-mercaptoethanol agglutination test. This test, it destroys the agglutinability of IgM and it does not alter IgG. So standard agglutination test performed in this 2-mercaptoethanol treated serum detect only IgG. Why? Because it destroys the agglutinability of IgM. And ELISA detecting antibodies to LPS antigen, they are more sensitive and they can detect IgM and IgG antibodies separately also. So apart from these serological tests, there are few molecular methods also like PCR. This PCR, it is targeted against RRS, RLL gene, outer membrane protein 2 gene or insertion sequence IS711. And also Brucella skin test and guinea pig inoculation were done earlier, but these are obsolete now. So this is about diagnosis of brucellosis in man. So how to diagnose brucellosis in animals? What is the need to diagnose brucellosis in animal so that it doesn't spread? Because the infection of brucellosis is from animals to man. So one is by isolation from milk and dairy products, that is culture of the cream of cow's milk or any cattle. One, you can go for antibody detection in milk. This is widely used method. They do milk ring test. Here what happens in this procedure, pooled milk is taken, to that a drop of stained Brucella antigen is added and it is incubated at 70 degrees centigrade for around 1 hour or 40 to 50 minutes. So here in this figure, can you see here, it is a positive reaction and it is a negative reaction. Positive means you can see blue ring at the top with milk unstained. Okay, here the blue ring you can see because the bacilli have been agglutinated, they rise with the cream to form a blue ring at the top. Negative test means the suspension remains uniform and there is no blue ring. Other than this milk ring test, you can also go for rose bengal card test and whey agglutination test. But among these three, milk ring test is more commonly used or preferred. So this is about diagnosis of brucellosis in animals. Coming to the treatment. So the gold standard regimen is streptomycin for 14 to 21 days, that is 2 to 3 weeks, plus doxycycline for 6 weeks. This is the standard regimen. Whereas WHO has given that rifampin should be used for 6 weeks plus doxycycline for 6 weeks. So both rifampin and doxycycline for 6 weeks have to be used. But relapse or treatment failure can occur only in about 5 to 10% of cases. And when there is CNS involvement, ceftriaxone is added and the treatment should be prolonged. That is based on the clinical condition of the patient again. It has to be prolonged. Then coming to the prevention. So how do you prevent this in animals? Active case finding by skin test, that is Brucellin test, which is of course obsolete now, or complement fixation test, or there are live vaccines available also, live attenuated vaccine using Brucella abortus 19 strain for the cattle and Brucella melitensis RV1 strain for sheep and goat can be used. This is about prevention in animals. Then how to prevent in humans, how to prevent the infection in humans? General precautions like to use only pasteurized milk or properly cooked food and to prevent the direct contact with the animals. Here live attenuated vaccine of Brucella abortus 19 BA strain can be used for humans, whereas for animals it is only Brucella abortus. reactogenicity. What is this reactogenicity? Reactogenicity means nothing but the reactions that occur soon after the vaccination. That means the physical manifestation of the inflammatory response to the vaccines. So there occurs high reactogenicity. There will be high reactogenicity and there will be only short-term protection also by vaccines. But still, it can be used. So that's all about brucellosis. Before that, let's see how much you have gained from this session. So Brucella melitensis is commonly found in which animals? Melitensis. Which animal or animals? Pig, dog, cattle, goat, sheep. One is goat and the other is sheep. And Marta fever is also called as undulant fever. So what is this undulant fever? There will be rise and fall of the fever as a typical course. And the last one, all of the following serological tests would be helpful in diagnosis of chronic brucellosis except SAT, mercaptoethanol, complement fixation test, ELISA. Yes, standard agglutination test. It does not differ.